Yeah.
And the city itself has been kind of quiet about it. You know, I mean, we all think it's a big deal.
It's good that Anne Frantilla thinks it's a big deal that Seattle incorporated as a city in 1869. Seattle is a century and a half old, and the Municipal Archives, which were only created in the 1980s, is responsible for taking care of 15 decades worth of priceless materials. But these aren't just a bunch of musty old papers that never see the light of day. In these priceless photos and documents are the hidden backstories of Seattle's streets, neighborhoods, and people.
This is the cemetery. Yep, plat of old cemetery.
Jean Fisher works in the archives.
And it, down here it says, vacated July 10th, 1884.
An old ledger and map are the only record of 400 burials in Seattle's first cemetery, which later became its first park.
The land was donated by the Dennys, and it was originally a cemetery, and then in 1884, the cemetery became the city's first park, Denny Park. And so all of the bodies had to be moved from the municipal cemetery to different locations.
Jean Fisher says that sometimes documents created for one purpose become valuable for entirely different reasons. She points to a multi-page complaint from the 1930s about a downtown newsstand encroaching on a nearby business that included photos as evidence.
But what's so great about them is they're also kind of snapshots of the city at that time. So you can see pedestrians, you can see the businesses, you can see the streets. And that's something that you find, you know, in photos all the time in the archives, that they show something that is really interesting that's not necessarily the reason why it was created.
And it's another complaint that Anne Frantilla says perfectly illustrates the value of archival materials to understand earlier times.
We have the records of the cities that were annexed to the city. And these were petitions regarding livestock boundaries.
And what exactly was that long-ago Ballard citizen's beef? Another citizen's beef.
We considered it an imposition to have 25 or 30 cows herded right in our door yard, and each cow with a bell on it. And this is the best line. Also, these herd boys use all kinds of profane and obscene language in the presence of women who come near them.
The cows, if not the cussing, are long gone from Ballard, but the Municipal Archives also has extensive documentation of some proposed projects in other parts of town that never came to be in the first place. In the 1960s, the Thompson Expressway would have bisected the Arboretum and the Japanese Garden. The Archives has what can only be called beautiful artist renderings of what it might have looked like to have a freeway running right through this iconic, tranquil spot. Julie Eyrick is the city's photo archivist. She says a focus of the 150th anniversary is broadening standard interpretations to better reflect the diversity that's been there in the old pictures all along, such as from this anti-housing discrimination protest along Aurora Avenue in the 1960s.
We had to look closely at the demonstration records from the redlining era and try not to center those entries on what the white people were doing in the photographs, but rather what were the black people doing in the photographs, since they were the ones being affected by the redlining.
And let's hope the Seattle Municipal Archives keeps preserving and making accessible the records of the city's first 150 years and its next 150 years, and all the years that follow.
I think one of the most interesting things, or one of the best things to come out of this, will be that public awareness, and that we are holding the records of that important conversation that occurs between citizens and their own government.
Watch CityStream Thursday nights at 7 on the Seattle Channel, or get video on demand and podcasts anytime at seattlechannel.org.